this is the title of the talk. It's with Anna Bayona from the Business School and Xavier Vives, who is here. And let me introduce what this is. So this is I'm going to present some data from a lab experiment which studies a particular comparative statics prediction of a supply function equilibrium model. So it's really it's a lab experiment on a comparative statics, and the supply function model that we have is a setting that is representative of some real world markets in which there's competition in demand or supply functions. So in a sense, we're not choosing, but the model that we use, we think has really the feature that is relatively close to how some markets really are. So, and it's less abstract, or the distance between how it is, how the model is and how things are is less big than in other cases. That's why, in a sense, we think this makes sense. So, and these markets of this type, for instance, wholesale electricity markets, that's the one that I always think of, but also markets for pollution permits or liquidity in treasury auctions. And the comparative statics prediction that we look at has to do with market power. It's about something, when you change something, then market power will be higher, and that's what we're going to look at. And this is a central issue in I.O. And let me also say that the motivation for studying the comparative statics is because many lab experiments that have to do with I.O. models, what they find is that comparative statics of what the equilibrium would suggest come through, not necessarily exactly the prediction, right? So for instance, very simple example is the effect of numbers in oligopoly. So if you have Cournot, if you have quantity competition game, and then you look at the Cournot equilibrium changes with n, and then if you do the lab experiment, you're not going to get exactly the equilibrium in each case, but you're going to get that the equilibrium moves with n in the natural way. And that's also true for other cases, right? So in a sense, we're in this line of checking comparative statics prediction that we think is interesting, and we're really interested mostly in the comparative statics, not necessarily in that exactly what the model prescribes happens. And it's going to be about the relation between market power and informational friction. And let me little by little introduce how this is going to work, or what we do. We have a competitive environment. We're going to have three sellers, and they compete in supply function for an inelastic demand. And there's going to be a multi-unit uniform price auction. So it's uniform price. That's very important. And the information environment is the following. Bidders are uncertain about their own costs and also the costs of other bidders in the same market. But like in so many cases, bidders don't know their costs, but they receive a private signal about their own costs. And costs can be decomposed into a common and an idiosyncratic component, as you'll see in a second. And then here's basically the basic thing that we're going to look at. Costs can be either uncorrelated or positively correlated. And this change in correlation actually affects what happens in the equilibria, and we're going to look at in a lab experiment whether this change that the change in the correlation parameter prescribes, whether it comes through in the data. So I'm actually going to skip this a bit. So related literature theory, there's some stuff on supply function equilibrium. So the one I cannot skip is the one by Vives, 2011. It's not because Xavier is here, but it's because it's the experiment is based on his model. It's a basically a numerical, a particular case of his case. There's other lab experiments on supply functions, and there's also field evidence on electricity markets, and our stuff is also related to some other experiments, and I'm not going to go into this, but if you want later, we can talk. So this is the baseline model. So this is going to be a one-shot game, and it is a one-shot game, and we're going to play it as a one-shot game in a way that I'll explain. And Seller's profit is this. It's P with the price, which is a uniform price, minus theta sub I, which is his unit cost, times the amount he sells, minus lambda half to the square, that multiplies the square of this, right? And P is the market price, XI is the unit supplied, theta sub I is the random cost shock, and lambda is the transaction cost parameters, which just says that if you produce more, then there's some additional cost from doing that. And then there's some distribution. So the distribution of theta is a normal with this mean and this variance, and for I different from j, and then there's going to be a correlation equal to rho, and costs are going to be either correlated, so we're going to have this rho is going to be zero in some cases, and in some other, in the other case, it's going to be a positive value, which I'll tell you in a second. And each seller has incomplete information about this cost. So the cost that you see here, he doesn't know with certainty. And he receives, or she receives, a noisy private signal, like in so many other cases, right? So that is here. This is a signal, which is the sum of the true parameter plus this epsilon, which is a noise parameter, which is normally distributed. And a seller's strategy is a linear price contingent schedule, which is characterized by slope C and an intercept that is here. Now, the important thing is we are going to have only linear schedules. We're going to allow only for linear schedules. And the demand is going to be inelastic, equal to a certain number, and we're going to have a uniform price auction. Okay? Good. So now you can see that you see the first picture. So, of course, behind this picture, this is the equilibrium bidding in the two cases. The flatter lines are for rho equal to zero. So no correlation between costs. And the steeper lines are for a certain value of rho that we chose. So of course, behind this graph, there are a number of parameter choices. So we choose some numbers for all kinds of things. Let me just tell you a few of those. So first, one that's worth knowing is n, the number of firms is 3, and the correlation is 0.6. So in the flat case, this is how you should bid if there's no correlation, and the steep thing is what you should bid when there is correlation. Now, in a way, the key thing is to see this graph and then to see why this makes sense. So think of it in the following way. If you will have no correlation, then how do you think of bidding? You have the signal, to which is what you know about your costs, and then starting from that, in a way, then you think, what about if the price is higher? And the higher the price, you're going to offer a little bit more, because this is like a pure supply effect. And the key is not what I just said, but the comparison to what I'll say next. So what happens if there is correlation? Then it's a bit, it starts in a similar way. I have this signal for my cost, but now if the price is higher, if price increases, then I have to take into account that in this case, the price reveals information about how things are. And basically, a higher price now tells you that the others have higher costs. And because my own cost is correlated, I also have higher costs. And therefore, for the same price increase, I should actually increase my offer, the amount I offer, less. That's the basic story, in a way. So the basic thing is going to be to compare these two, what happens in this case with what happens in this case. This comes from no correlation. This comes from correlation equal to 6. And I just gave you the intuition behind this difference. And our focus is on whether the data are consistent with the comparative statics of the model. So in a way, we just would like higher slope, higher price, higher profits also, of the positively correlated cost treatment in relation to the no correlation, right? Now, of course, if things were perfect, then things would look like exactly here, but it could be that it's not that perfect, so it just looks a bit approximately like this. Okay, so this is what I'm going to tell you about the theory. Now I'm going to tell you some about the experiments, and I'm going to just show you some data. So how did we do this? Well, we have we see this as a one-shot game, which is what the theory prescribes. Of course, in electricity markets, people or companies compete over time, always with the same people, but we see it as a one-shot game. So we're going to have random matching of people. So we're going to have the following. We're going to have two treatments, uncorrelated, correlated, and we're going to have always 12 people in a session which are rematched every round in groups of 3, right? And we have a total of 6 groups of 12 that are rematched in this way, right? So 6 independent groups, there's 4 markets. Is this working? Or am I? I don't know. Oh. Yeah, I don't know if the red thing, I don't see. In any case, so you can see 4 markets of 3, so that's 4 times 12, 4 times 3 is 12 times 6, so that's how this comes around. And we're going to have rounds, which is a classic thing in experiments you repeat to allow for learning. It could, of course, be that at the beginning this is something very strange happens, but that it goes away after some time. So this is between subject design. This means that people only are either in the uncorrelated case or in the correlated case. You don't see both. Would it make sense to have people play both? It could make sense because it could help learning, but we didn't do it that way. And this is, all I'm going to show you is student subjects, right? Well, let me just say about this that we also have a little bit of data, not much, about professional subjects. And there's basically no difference between student subjects and professional subjects, although, as I said, for professionals, we don't have so much data, so I don't want to make a big deal out of it. So then in each round, each participant receives a private signal according to a normal, and we explained that to people. And decision is each seller submits a linear supply function, and then they actually get a lot of feedback. You get feedback about how much you sold, about the price, about your profits, but you also get the same feedback about for the others, which is in a way a lot of feedback. But you don't. The only thing you're not told about the others is the signal they saw. Okay, so now I think from now on I just show you some pictures. So here, this is the first thing, and that is in a, here you can see, I have, yeah, so here, this is in here on the top, you see the intercept in the uncorrelated case and the correlated case, and for the different signal deciles. So you can see the green cross is the experimental average, so it's the actual data, and the red diamond is the theoretical thing. So you can see that actually it is quite on top of it, so that looks good, yeah.
Just a clarification question, so the random matching, is that every round you're matching, or are you staying
the same? No, no, so there's this group of 12, and within this group you're always thrown around.
I'm more cognitively demanding because you have to make more inferences.
Sure, that is a problem, right? I mean, you will see. So, and then on the right, you see here this for positively correlated cost treatments. You can already see that the green and red are not on top of each other. You will see in a moment a much clearer representation, but you can see that green is actually above red, right? So, the intercept. Is actually above what it should be. And in the bottom, you see the same thing for the slopes, right? So this is like very simple way to show it. And you can see again that for correlated, uncorrelated case, the red and the green are on top of each other. So for the slope, it's even a bit better than here. But here you see the big discrepancy that for any kind of signal, if you want, there's a big discrepancy between the one thing and the other. And now this is the graph that is probably the simplest thing to take away from this talk. You can see here the average, so in green you can see the average supply function for treatment zero, which is no correlation, and the equilibrium supply function for treatment zero. Right? And basically one is on top of each other, I mean one is a bit higher, but it's not significant. So fundamentally the slope, or better, the function, the average function, for the uncorrelated case is that we see in the data is exactly like the prediction of the model. At the same time, two things, right? For the correlated case, it is not, the data are not like the equilibrium, and moreover, actually the data are just like the data for the uncorrelated case, right? And the things that this graph suggests are all right, right? So the three things here are not statistically significant from each other, and then this red thing is statistically significantly different from this, right? So, I mean, this is not just a graph, but it has some statistical validity. Okay, this is something that I just want to show you. This is, many numbers. Fundamentally, it shows the following, that the dispersion is higher in the uncorrelated, in the correlated case, right? So you can look at the dispersion in different ways. Because there's different ways of defining the standard deviation, but what you should see here is that in the uncorrelated case, these numbers are typically smaller. I don't know why. I don't know which thing to push here. It's so small. That's the thing. So this here is smaller. This number is smaller than this number. This smaller is not smaller than this number. This smaller is, and so on. So by any way of looking at the dispersion in the uncorrelated case is lower than in the correlated case. Now, what consequences does all this have? Well, it has consequences for prices, of course, that's kind of obvious, and profits, and also deadweight loss, but here you get to see it. So, why is this red source? So, first you can see, yeah, here. So, this is the mean price in the uncorrelated case, and this is what the equilibrium said. These are the profits in the case of uncorrelated, and this is what are the profits, what the theory said. Here, this is already not so obvious from the previous picture. It has to do with the fact that there's a lot of production inefficiency, so not the most efficient firms produce in each case, and profits are low. And on the other hand, you can see on the right, which is positively correlated, you can see clearly that the price is lower than the theoretical prediction, and you can see also that the profits are very much lower than the theoretical prediction. Right? So, what am I doing wrong with this? I don't know what I'm doing wrong. Okay, so 16,000 is what the profits should be, and they're only on average 1900, right? Okay, and deadweight loss has also some deviation. I'm not going to go into this. Now, one more thing that's worth looking, from the descriptive point of view, is what happens over time. So we have these guys played 25 rounds of this to see if, you know, maybe you need a little bit of time, and you can see now here that this is not a big problem. So on the left, you see the intercept, the theoretical intercept, and the actual intercept in the data. And on the right, you see the slope. That's maybe the most stark result. You can see the following, that it's what I already showed you, and it's not going away. So for green, which is the uncorrelated case, it actually starts out quite close already from the start, and if at all, it gets a little better, right? It gets even a little closer, descriptively. But for red, it's far away, and it doesn't get closer. If at all, it gets a little closer to the equilibrium of the uncorrelated case, right? So there's really not much, we also studied this by estimating learning models. So there's not much evidence of learning. There's a little bit of learning. You can see what happens there on the right, right? I mean, the green thing goes down, the red thing goes down a little bit. There's a little bit of learning, but learning is not important, and it doesn't, eliminate the fundamental thing. So here's one more nice graph, which shows you the best response to the average that is observed. So on the left, you can see three things: equilibrium. You also see average first five rounds, and you see the best response to this, and you can see that it's all more or less on top of each other. But on the right, it's more interesting because you can see that equilibrium is the steep thing, and the flat, very flat thing, that's the average first five rounds, and the thing in the middle, that's the best response to the average, observed average, right? So in a sense, if you best respond, you go in the red direction of the equilibrium. That sounds like maybe promising. It doesn't really, in the time that we give them, it doesn't go, it doesn't do so much, but it's how it is. Okay, so the last thing I'm going to show you is, it's also descriptive, is to try to look a little bit more at individual behavior, not just give you these averages. And what we did is we did this cluster analysis. And the cluster has to do with, is done in the following way. Think of each person over time, but I show you for first five periods. Each person for the first five periods, you just take their average intercept and you take the average slope and you plot it here, right? And then you can see at the cross there, so on top you have uncorrelated, and the bottom is correlated. Right? And at the top, you can see the following. At the cross, that's basically where the equilibrium is. Right? And if you ask the data to tell you what the clusters are, then you're going to get this, right? That cluster one is equilibrium, right? It's a little bit off, but it classifies as equilibrium. It's this black stuff here. Oh, now it works. And then you have some others who have a steeper supply function with a slower intercept. They're already kind of deviating, but it's not so bad because there's more people here. And also, you can look at this. This is first five rounds and last five rounds, and this actually gets a little better in the last five rounds. So in the last five rounds, you're going to have more of these people moving over here and being in this cluster. Right? I think it's 50. So here you have 58% of people in the equilibrium cluster, and at the end of things, you have 72% in the equilibrium cluster. Now, if you look at down here, this is now the equilibrium, would be equilibrium behavior for the correlated case, and you can see that there's really not many people here, right? So there's three slopes. So how do we do this? There's one group which we call correlation neglect, which is these are the people who basically behave as if there is no correlation, right? They behave as if, in a way, they are playing like, as you saw before, they play the equilibrium of this here, right? So there's some people who are, we call correlation neglect. Then we have some people who have very steep slope and low intercept. They're kind of taking the focal point of the origin and then going from there. And then cluster two, these are the guys that we saw a bit before, cluster two with between the previous two benchmarks. So these people are people who can be interpreted as being more sophisticated and trying to best respond to what the others do. Now, this does not become much better, whereas this at the top actually becomes a little better over time. This stays like this. So they are these best responders, but they don't grow very much over time. Please.
Do you have data on cognitive ability?
No.
In response to that?
No. So the one thing I can tell you is that we went to the Iberian market in Madrid and we don't have much data. We only have one session with traders with correlation and traders without correlation. And there's no difference between them. Right? So I don't know, maybe they have lower cognitive ability than our students, and we don't have that data, but it's what I can say. Okay, and so the summary in conclusions, you saw it. So this is an experiment which reflects some of the complexity of some markets where computers compete in supply functions and incomplete information, and you saw how we do this. And so we write here, this is always want to write something. The theoretical model is useful in organizing common predictions in both treatments. Well, at the beginning you saw at least that the signals actually did to the slope and the intercept what they were supposed to do in terms of changing, right? So the slope should be independent from the signal, and the intercept should depend on the signal, and that came through. That's the thing that we can call a victory about. And then behavior in the uncorrelated cost treatment is consistent with the equilibrium. Behavior in the correlated cost inconsistent equilibrium, but consistent with the equilibrium for the uncorrelated case. You saw this. Now, explanations, right? This is now the thing. So one very simple, which is covered under the name correlation neglect, is they just don't register that there is correlation, right? But of course, more reasonable is that they do register what is correlation, that there is correlation. We explain correlation quite well to them, I think. Many of them understand it, but they, in a way, they don't know how to take into account that the price reveals information. So this idea that if you think of higher prices, then you have to think that the price will be higher because others have higher signals and higher costs, and you should take that into account. That's not so easy, right? And sometimes this is called the generalized winner's curse. Now, if you want to become economic, so cost correlation does not lead to market power, if you want to. And so if our experiment reflects behavior in real markets, then competition authority should be wary of high prices since they may indicate collusion. That means if you have a case like this and you do see high prices, then it may not have to do with correlation, but with people just coming up with ways of sustaining high prices. Okay, so this is it. In the uncorrelated. In a sense, we're not sure why they do so well in the uncorrelated case, right? I mean, we know that the other case is very much off, but this is right on the point, right? We're not sure how they do it. I mean, one possibility is they figure out the equilibrium, right? But we cannot be sure how they figure this out, but they do. Please.
The clusters are being done on the basis of the estimates of the intercept and the slope. The clustering graphs that you showed.
Yeah.
It was the cost. For each individual, you have the estimates of the slope.
Yes, yes, yes.
These estimates are themselves random. Mm-hmm. Priorly, you would expect one group. The issue is how many groups do you have? Is there some theory? Because in clustering, that's the issue of how many groups.
Yeah, but I guess, I mean, there are, yeah, so. There are ways to do this, right? I mean, there are ways to, you give them some loss function and you have to give them some input, and then there are these programs that at the same time calculate how many groups and which groups, right? I noticed that in one case it actually says there are two groups, in the other it says three groups. But I think you can also change that. So if you want, every point is a group, right? So if you increase the number of possible groups, then it will be not very informative.
You may have to take into account that each estimate itself has standard error.
Yeah, I think Anna did this, so I don't know exactly, but it's an estimation. It's an estimation, yeah. Right? It's not a graphical thing where we just say these guys belong together, but it's estimated. Please.
Okay. So I'm not sure that if you had some data, one very good player, for example, who really seems to play according to the equilibrium in the passing of the equilibrium case, do you have a sense of whether the other players learn from him?
The other players?
Learn from him. So if you have one very good player who seems to really understand the correlation, do the others seem to adapt from that, or even in this case, they just stay with him?
So I mean, at the disaggregated level, I don't know. I don't think we have looked at that, and I don't know. But I guess on the aggregated level, you see it because you have these best responders in the first five rounds. So, you know, there are some people who are doing it not too badly. I mean, they're not so perfect best responders, and you could imitate them, or even people just by inspection, by thinking, could be starting to move there, but you don't have that. So it doesn't look like the fraction of best responders is really increasing over time. That I can say. But we didn't look at it market per market. It's complicated because these guys get thrown around in this 12 people group. Right?
Thank you.
Thanks.